Good afternoon, everyone.
Good afternoon.
Hello.
Welcome to the InfoCity lecture series. My name is Chris Ham, and I am one of the members of InfoCity. So, what do you get when you take a community business, a community nonprofit, an academic center, an academic department? You get InfoCity. We are here to really look and examine and dig deep into the situation of the digital divide in our community. The digital divide is not at just the individual level, but when you have a certain number or a mass group of people who have the digital divide, then it affects the entire community. And so here in Champaign, Urbana, we have the University of Illinois, we have Parkland, we have Research Park, we have lots of these huge tech companies, but we still have huge pockets that those places have no impact on in our community. And so we're here to look at everything that's going on in the community and see what we can do, what is our part to connect everyone together so we don't have these disparities. So, like I said, my name is Christopher Ham. I own and operate Chrisp Media, which is a local web consulting company. We also in the building have Brian Bell. He is the founder of the Digital Equality Initiative, that is a local nonprofit. We have Dr. Kate Williams. She is over the Community Informatics Research Center. We have Noel Lister on the camera. He is a PhD student in Graduate School of Library Information Science. Walking around taking pictures is Angela Slates. She is a PhD student in education. And in the back of the room, we have our Professor Emeritus, Dr. Alkalimat. And so he gives us a lot of our wisdom. And so with that, I want to tell you some of the things that we've already done. So many of you might already be familiar with eBlackCU. eBlackCU is now a part of InfoCity. Also, the CU Wiki project, that now also is a part of InfoCity. And in fact, anybody who doesn't have an entry on CU Wiki, we encourage you to run to the back of the room, not while we're talking, but at the end, and get an entry on there. And I forgot to mention Dr. Ron Bailey. He couldn't make it there, but he's over as a part of African American Studies on campus. He also is affiliated with InfoCU. And so we are looking for people to join us. If you are an individual who wants to get involved, let us know. If you have an organization or a business want to get involved, we're looking for partners. What does it mean to be a partner? One, you agree to come to an annual meeting. We want to meet at least once a year to say, where are we now? Where are we going? What have we done? Also, we want to publicly acknowledge that you're affiliated with us. So we'll put a link on our website, and we want you to share information that's related to information and technology in the community, and we will help publicize it, and we'll try to attend. And then finally, we want you to be open to the idea of internships, because we cannot talk about InfoCity without considering the economic development component. And so we want our community partners, whether it's free or paid, because experience often is more valuable than money, to be open so we can get community members out into the different segments of our community working on IT. And so if you want to be a partner, you can sign up on our website. We have a Facebook page, and we're going to push out tons of information. And when you sign in today, if you choose to sign up for our newsletter, we promise we won't spam you. Most of our information will be on the Facebook page and on our website. We're going to start sending out a monthly newsletter. And so when you sign up and check that box, that means you'll be receiving our newsletter. And now I would like to introduce Dr. Kate Williams, who's going to come up and give a little more information and introduce our speaker for today. Thank you.
Chris didn't mention it, but he is actually the chair of Information City CU. Thanks for doing that, Chris. These lectures actually started in fall of 2008, and with this particular lecture, we're making an important turn into the community. The Community Informatics Research Lab, which is led by Professor, now Emeritus, Abdul Alkalimat and myself, began these events as the Digital Divide lecture series. Very soon, all the lectures were video recorded and shared online, but they all happened on campus. They were all at the Graduate School of Library and Information Science. The Department of African American Studies was also involved, and I want to thank them because they supplied the refreshments today. So this fall, we begin our Information City partnership with Chrisp Media and with the Digital Equality Initiative, and others are also joining InfoCity. So the lectures had to start happening off campus. In other words, we're taking aim at the town-gown divide as well as the digital divide. There is no better way to start our community-based lectures than with Mark Henderson. Mark is the University of Illinois' new CIO, Chief Information Officer, and in this town, what the university does affects all of us. Mark brings some remarkable experience from Cleveland, where he was for the past 4 years. He served as Senior IT Manager and ultimately as Interim Vice President and CIO at Case Western Reserve University, like the University of Illinois, a large research university. He has worked in IT for 32 years, ever since graduating from Xavier University in Cincinnati. He began his career at Procter & Gamble and then Westinghouse Electric. He moved back to Cincinnati, working for 5 years in the private sector and then 4 years at the University of Cincinnati. He did 4 years in IT at the University of Maryland and 8 years at General Electric, GE, always at progressively more responsible IT positions. In Cleveland, he was also involved in the community in two important ways. He volunteered as a board member, and I think in other ways as well, at Micah's House, a reentry program for men leaving prison. And then he also was on the board and worked and volunteered at One Community. One Community is important because it's very similar to UCUB here in town, and yet we'll learn from Mark different in some ways. It was a federal broadband project that has a 10-year history as opposed to our somewhat shorter history with UCUB as far as providing internet service and I think other services as well to the public and nonprofit sector in Cleveland and in 20 counties surrounding Cleveland. So through this work, One Community helped transform these sectors, speeded them up, literally, with a better broadband connection, and helped them figure out ways to serve the communities that they were in new ways. Mark arrived here in the middle of August, and he's just starting to update the IT plans of the university. But the search committee that brought him here for his experience and his insights. And that's what he wants to share, and we want him to share with you today, because they relate very much to Champaign, Urbana as an information city. So please help me welcome Mark Henderson.
Well, thank you very much. I'm very pleased to be here. I'm off to an inauspicious start. I misspelled lecture, I fat-fingered it, so my wife was kind enough to point that out to me. So despite the use of technology, bad stuff in, bad stuff out. I'm new to the area, so I'm still learning our way around Champaign-Urbana. I'm learning the university, I'm learning the community, and what I can tell you is the things that I've seen so far are quite impressive. There's an awful lot here to work with. Having a great university is at the cornerstone of transformation. A research park, which is growing, just offers unbundled opportunity. And then the investments that are made in UC2B will be, in the long term, incredibly important, I think, for development, for luring businesses here, for job creation. So I wrote down, I have a presentation here, which is it's kind of pulled together from a number of presentations. And I will tell you right now, I didn't want to get ahead of myself, because I probably will not be overly direct on what I'm planning on doing at the university, because I have not yet socialized that with my boss. So I don't want to get ahead of myself. And then other stakeholders, the Vice Chancellor for Research, and then our whole IT governance process. So what I'd like to do is just offer a couple of thoughts, and I would invite you to please weigh in, please ask questions. And the first thing I want to start with is just how pervasive IT is and the people who practice it. So I'm going to tell you a story about Bob. He's an IT guy. All right, and Bob got sent on a special assignment, which took him to the four corners of the world, where he did consulting and a whole lot of very beneficial things for the customers that he supported. Bob got back in town, and he had a very good friend named John. And so John was on his way to a party, and John thought, well, you know what? Let me call Bob and see if he would like to go to the party. And so he called Bob, and Bob said, I'd love to go to the party, but I gotta give you a heads up. I know everybody and everybody knows me. And that's not dissimilar to IT people in general, especially if you're having a problem. And so John said, okay, I'll pick you up. So he picks him up, they go to the party, and literally everyone in the party walks up and says, Bob, how you doing? How you been? It's good to see you, glad that you came. And so John's very confused. And he said, what is this all about? And Bob said, I told you, I know everybody and everybody knows me. And so he said, I don't believe you. He said, I bet you $100 you don't know the governor. He said, I don't want to take your money, let's go. They drove to Springfield, they go to the governor's mansion, they knock on the door, the governor answers and says, Bob, how are you? Good to see you. We really appreciate the work that you did for the state. And so John said, you know him? The governor said, of course I know him. He said, then Bob said, thank you, sir. I won't take up any more of your time. We'll be on our way. And so they leave. And by this time, John is really perplexed. And so he's, all right, you knew the governor. He said, I bet you $500 you don't know President Obama. He said, I want to take your money, but let's go. So they go to the airport, they get on a plane, they fly to D.C., they catch a cab, they come to the White House. The Secret Service says, Bob, we haven't seen you in a while. He said, what can we do for you? And he said, we're here to see the president. Oh, yes. So they escort him in. The president comes down from the residence. He says, Bob, I want to thank you for all the work that you did at Transportation and Commerce and in the Department of Defense. We really owe you a lot. You did us a great service. And John says, you know him? He said, of course, I know Bob. He did us a great service. And so Bob said, thank you, Mr. President. We don't want to take any more of your time. And so they leave. So they're out on Pennsylvania Avenue, and John really is beside himself. He said, all right, I believe it. You know the president, you knew the governor. He said, I bet you $1,000 you don't know the Pope. He said, I don't want to take your money. They jump on the plane, they fly to Rome, they get a taxi to Vatican City, they get to St. Peter's Square. There are 100,000 people in St. Peter's Square waiting on the blessing. And so Bob says to John, it's really crowded. Let me make my way through. And John said, aha, I think I have you now. And so time went by, and then a cheer went over the crowd, and everybody was looking at the Pope. The Pope is looking at everybody. The Pope is waving. People are waving at the Pope. And the Pope has his arm around Bob. And so Bob looks out in the crowd, and he sees his friend John just keel over. And so he jumps down. He makes his way through the crowd. He gets to his friend John. He says, John, what happened? And John comes to him. He said, you know what? I can understand that you knew the governor. I can even appreciate the fact that you knew the president. He said, what I couldn't take was the guy next to me said, who is the guy with his arm around Bob? And that's a lot like IT people. You know, we are called upon for all kinds of reasons. I've had all kinds of calls from people who just reach to me because they know the name. They know that IT is at the heart of everything. And that is true. And that is a reality that we have to embrace and prepare for. So technology is everywhere. I mean, it permeates every part of our lives. Our world has changed as a result of it. I mean, the world is a very, very small place now. I watched a very disturbing video, and again, technology enabled it. So these things are becoming instantaneously available. Information, data, in all myriad forms. This is disturbing video was of a black woman who was walking along the highway in LA, and a state police officer tried to corral her, and she pushed away. He knocked her to the ground and went to beating her. Okay? The stuff happening in Ferguson, I mean, the information is available, and more it is in digital form. So we have to embrace that, and we have to orient ourselves accordingly. So, you know, you have cloud services, you have technology as a service, these devices. Students, and I suspect it's the same case here at Illinois, but students at Case Western Reserve came to the university with 7 wireless devices. 7. So all of our efforts were in trying to keep up with this. You know, it's an arms race of sorts. And so we have to understand and make some difficult choices as to where we put our investments. In our case there, we spent less amount of time on the wired network and significantly a lot of time and energy on the wireless network. Devices like these come with no wired connectivity much anymore. So that's the new reality. You know, technology is in all aspects of our lives, even when we don't even think about it. You know, there's technology that allows for surveillance. There is technology when you go to many of these places where everything that you do is recorded. It goes into tremendously large databases, and that by people who are interested in trend analysis. But technology is in all aspects of our lives. I was watching a video, I think it was last night, where cars now are there are networks within the cars, but then the cars are networked to broader sensors, which are networked to the World Wide Web, which is, they're capturing data even as to how you conduct your life within your car. When I worked at GE, I worked for GE Aviation, my wife still does, but we used to capture in-flight data on planes between points. And we could do things like inform pilots on or their airlines operation centers on how they could more efficiently run the engines based on the data that they were bringing down real time. I mean, data. It's a great time to be here. What I want to do, if you'll allow me, I want to share a really interesting video that really speaks to this. And although this was produced by Corning, I would ask that you don't think about Corning and really just look at the day in the life of. Thank you. that gives you a notion of the art of the possible and how technology permeates every aspect of our lives. What I would suggest to you is, although this is a Corning production and really they're highlighting the glass, the realities are that many of those technologies exist today. We were working at Case Western Reserve, we were working with the new medical school and building it. And the dean said that in terms of transforming medical education, this is the kind of stuff that she wanted in the classroom. She wanted to get away from cadavers, she wanted to get away from any number of things. And how do we use technology so that it is transformative? And that's also in the practice, that's also in the practice of medicine. So, having talked a bit about technology and how it permeates our lives, digital literacy is something we all have to pay very close attention to. Because if that is the future, then we all have to be capable of operating in that future. And it's not just beginning with our children, it's generational digital literacy. Because as you see, more and more things are being moved to self-service because technology is enabling that. So you have to be capable of working in those kinds of environments. You know, this picture particularly tickled me because we have a granddaughter and she is 2.5 years old and will go in my wife's purse, grab her iPhone, fire it up, swipe, pull up things until she gets to what it is that she wants. I spent time in the Apple store in Cleveland one spring evening and I was just blown away by the number of very small kids who are using technology now. It's baked into their lives now. And this generation, our kids, our granddaughter's generation will never know a time before technology and the internet. That's where they begin. So we cannot, you know, we talk about financial divides and gaps. You know, I fear that, you know, that will pale into insignificance when compared to digital literacy gaps. And so we have to pay attention to that. We have to put programs in place that lifts everyone up and levels the digital playing field. And this kid kind of cracked me up too. You know, no, grandma, listen. That's about how it is these days. You know, the other thing around digital literacy is just that knowledge is power. And how do you get knowledge? You get knowledge through information. And how do you get to information? Through technologies now. And that becomes more and more important because you can still read newspapers, but they are a dying institution. People are pulling down their information, and not only the information that the newspapers produce and what they write about, but they're pulling things down into applications like Flipboard, those things which they want to read about. So there's an awful lot of choice, and being digitally literate gives you the ability to make those kinds of choices. Healthcare is moving more and more to the individual, and more people will be served in the healthcare arena through technology. We did a lot of work with telemedicine at Case. We wound up wiring a whole, I don't want to call it a retirement home, but these are people who were, you know, former Case workers, either faculty or staff, and they were in a high-rise, and we wired the whole thing and wired it to the Cleveland Clinic and to University Hospital. And when you think about moving people who may be infirmed, you know, you're talking anywhere between $300 and $500 an ambulance trip. And oftentimes that's just to get their blood pressure taken, their heart monitored. These are things that we were experimenting with over the internet. So we put very high definition monitors in the rooms. The doctors had those and they were able to conduct health checks with a lot of these people that way and reduce the cost. The biggest barrier to that technology is the insurance companies. They would not pay the doctors for those kinds of engagements. They'd rather pay for the ambulance than the people. But knowledge is power, and knowledge is informed by through information. And more it's digital. And we just have to bring people along, as I suggested before. It is generational. And through knowledge comes through information comes knowledge, and knowledge comes success, and information will become, in many respects, the coin of the realm going forward. You know, because it's those people who have information very quickly, who are able to act on that information, gain first mover status, that allows them to win. I mean, it's an amazing thing to see how much money a company like GE is pouring into data analysis. You know, that's all Google really does, is massive data analysis. Amazon, I mean, all of them are focusing on data analysis so that they can have information that will give, inform their decisions, that will give them first mover status. You know, in digital literacy, just in general, you gotta have it for educational reasons, healthcare, to gain access to information, you know, to provide for advancement, to get jobs in today's day and age, and to create other opportunities like beginning your own business. And so we have to raise everyone to some level of some equal footing in the digital environment. You know, the other thing that I see is that there are a lot of opportunities for university and community linkages. There are a lot today, but if I just look at the Kent University strategic plan,
you know, one was foster scholarship, discovery, and innovation.
Well, that should expand, that should not just be at the university, but should expand, you know, to the broader community, to the region, to the state, to the country, to the world.
And there's a lot of activity going on in that realm.
Provide transformative learning experiences. I mean, there are all kinds of technologies that can do that I'll talk about shortly.
And make a significant and visible societal impact.
I mean, what we're talking about in terms of addressing the digital divide, I think will have tremendous societal impact.
And then we have to steward current and generate new investment resources.
Well, if we can raise everyone up, you know, that creates for, you know, a workforce. And in my conversations with many chiefs of technology companies, in many instances where they're thinking about building new capacity, plants or offices or research parks, they take a very hard look at what is the education of the population. Are they digitally literate? Because it's from those groups that they're going to want to populate their organizations. How do we do that? Well, enabling the university's goals are any number of technologies. You know, and approaches, MOOCs, right? TED Talks should be utilized. Those are small snippets of video that inform on various subjects. Dialogue Cafe was an interesting initiative that we worked at CASE, and what it was putting Cisco's very high definition video teleconferencing system, telepresence, in locations around the world, and then inviting people to those locations to participate in dialogue. And so we at CASE would get a professor of something, and one of the more interesting ones was a professor of ethics, and her area of specialization is ethics in warfare. And so in Lisbon, we had the former prime minister and his former deputy minister of defense. We had a lot of people in London and Paris, in Australia, and there are a couple other places. But she kicked it off, which kind of framed the conversation. And then she just kind of backed away and helped to facilitate it. And it was very, very well attended. And that was just one of six pilot programs that we did. There are opportunities to bring those kinds of things here as well. That's another way of engaging the community, especially if we have the kinds of high capacity bandwidth connecting facilities around here. And then other collaborative tools and technologies. The outcomes are kind of self-evident. We have a better prepared workforce. We have lifelong learners, especially if it's easy to get at the material and the coursework. I was thinking of the right phrase. It escapes me. Also working on bringing up the community, it provides for a pool of future freshmen here at the university that we can pull from. And then just raising everyone up and reaching out provides leveling of the digital playing field. The importance of broadband, and as I mentioned before, is access. We talked about one community. This is the annual presentation that was given. And what I'll do is just highlight a couple of things. This is a Wordle that just talks about what one community provides. Because it was so important to the organization that communities participate in this, we worked on creating a $2 million pool of funds to see communities actually invested in themselves in terms of laying fiber and providing connectivity to businesses, to houses, to apartments in those communities. So you would come with a proposal, and we would provide funding out of this $2 million pool to help jumpstart those kinds of efforts. And then these are just some commentary from people who participated in it. Shaker Heights was really an early adopter. Now Shaker perhaps is a little different because it was a fairly well-funded community, but they began reaping benefits because there were new startups that located there out of the launch house. We connected a lot of students. So part of one community's mission was to connect all of the libraries, K through 12, universities, hospitals, and then that was on the grant side. And then on the self-sustaining side, we provided connectivity to businesses, to the university, the universities we charged, and others who were interested in participating in this. And providing high-speed connectivity to the schools allowed for any number of interactions, which I'll speak to shortly. We got a grant, and that's the other thing. When you have these kinds of assets in your community, you can apply for grants and compete for funding from the state and from the federal level to do any number of activities. In this case, we're looking at how you use Cisco telepresence in particular, but how do you use high bandwidth video to facilitate teaching and learning across the northeastern area. This was one that I was especially pleased with because we received some funding from the governor of the state of Ohio because health was a big initiative of his. And so the program that we put together was called Connected Health. We put telepresence facilities in two public schools in Cleveland, two public schools in Akron. We connected those facilities to the One Community Network. We had these telepresence capabilities around the university. And so there were doctors who put together a whole program around health and wellness, beginning with diabetes. And so they put together a program that educated students on better eating habits. And we were expanding that out to the students' parents in these areas. And we were looking at, and I left to come here, but we were looking at rolling this out statewide so that we could continue these kinds of things. And the medical school had put together a program that would have lasted over a two-year period in terms of their education. And although we started with health, we were extending that to other disciplines. Again, because we had the one community 100 gigabit connectivity from University Circle to downtown, we created something that's called the Health Corridor. Because in Cleveland, University Circle is where University Hospital, Case Western Reserve University exists. Euclid Avenue is the main boulevard that runs all the way downtown. And along Euclid is the headquarters of the Cleveland Clinic. And so by putting in this connectivity, we're able to generate interest on the parts of real estate developers because they were looking at building, I think it was six or seven facilities for startups because we teed off and provided 100 gigabit connection to these buildings. I mean, and then you could connect all the way down to the Global Health Innovation Center where a number of corporations located some of their research activities. And so the idea was enabled by technology, high bandwidth, is to create commerce and to really revitalize Cleveland. Cleveland had fell on some very hard times, as many other places did, you know, when the automobile industry took a hit. And it was a double whammy for Cleveland because it also was a steel industry center. So we were looking at opportunities to revitalize the community, and quite frankly, training and building up the workforce was a cornerstone of doing that, ergo connected health and STEM. And this gives you a notion of what I was talking about. Talking about the connected corridors. And we talked a bit about the Internet of Things. So what we paid very close attention with our partner Cisco to what they did in Barcelona. I don't know if you're aware of that, but Cisco invested millions and millions of dollars to make Barcelona a connected city on the premise of the Internet of All Things. So what they did is that they connected buildings, they could do smart power management, they could track through sensors traffic patterns. People who had software in their cars, they were alerted to where meters were available for parking. There was a smart bus system where you could gain all kinds of information in kiosks at the buses. All of the buses and trains were wirelessly enabled. So if you're working on something, you can go straight onto the bus or the train and have persistent connectivity. And it has opened up a number of opportunities for them, not the least of which is being able to compete for companies, for talent, to retain talent in their region because of these digital services that they provide. That's the other strength. We tried of having that kind of asset here. We were attempting to do something very similar in Cleveland. Connect up the buses and all, but then again, because we had that broadband connectivity. This last slide, the reason I put it in is because in order to make these things even remotely successful, you have to have the investment of people from all aspects of the community. So the chairman of our board was the chief information officer of Progressive Insurance Company. We had Lev Donick, who was the CEO of 1C, and he was my former boss at Case, who was he's known worldwide for innovation in the use of technology in higher education in particular. And we had people who had financial backgrounds and mergers and acquisitions and all. So the key here is that you have to have investment and commitment all across the board. A couple of closing thoughts is that as we are settling here in Champaign, all I see is just opportunities here. They abound. You know, and Kim and I were kind of laughing when we first came because we left Indianapolis and then there were cornfields and cornfields and cornfields. And then we get off to come here and all of a sudden, boom, here's a city. And I mean, it's not unlike cities, not as big, but I mean, it had all the things that you would expect to find in the city. And you have this great university here that is renowned in technology innovation, among other things. So just opportunity. UC2B has to play a very strong role in terms of providing connectivity. It's a jump starter for any number of things, as we've talked. The notion of making Champaign-Urbana a connected city, you know, there's any number of research activities that could take place as a result of something like that, or even in enabling that. Workforce preparation is an area that we have to work on, and that's where you can utilize technology to raise everyone's skills and abilities. But I will step back and say that people have to be willing to invest in themselves as well. It's not easy. There's no silver bullet. You know, the research part is just great. My organization was involved in providing a 10 gigabit connection from Caterpillar's facility in the research park back to their headquarters simulation lab. And as a result of that connectivity, they're going to move more and more work out of Peoria here to Champaign. And so that provides for job creation and further economic development. And then just job creation and new ventures by making these kinds of investments. You can lure companies here. You provide the infrastructure that entices startups to be here. But again, We have to get at many of the other things that I've mentioned. So I've talked quite a while. I'd like to ask you any questions, thoughts, comments. Sir.
Yeah, from the perspective of the University of Illinois, as a public university, I want to ask this sort of general question. During the industrial period, society developed public schools and public libraries in order to balance out the development of private industry and the population. In other words, preparing people for jobs, etc. In the digital age, it seems that Google and Amazon and other such companies are really promoting the privatization of public life. And we're encouraged to put our information in the private clouds, the gated communities that are controlled by these corporations. Unprecedented, Google is unprecedented in terms of the information about us. And when I say us, I mean humanity. And so I wonder how the public sector is going to have to develop, like the University of Illinois, or the Champaign Public Schools, the public libraries, like where we are now, in order to preserve the integrity of the population, the freedom, the privacy, the agency of the public in this new era of absolute corporate control of the clouds that contain all the information.
Well, in higher education in general, we have an organization called Internet 2. And through Internet 2, which is made up of 200 plus institutions, and we're funding the creation of many of those kinds of capabilities in and among our own community. So we will have alternatives. We won't just have that, and those things will be largely under our guidance and direction. So that's one. Two, in terms of a public higher education institution, that's land grant. You know, I think there's the evolution of the land grant mission, and I think that technology enables that evolution. And so there are ways to, you know, leverage technologies to maintain that mission and expand it beyond just, you know, dealing in agriculture and research around that, but in dealing perhaps with some of the things I mentioned earlier, you know, helping to uplift the digital literacy. Level out the digital playing field. You're right, it is unprecedented that, and Google is just an example, I mean, Amazon is the same way. I mean, I'll name one, Dell is doing that. Dell has invested millions of dollars in their social media command center. And so they sift through all information on the internet relative to any things, tweets, Facebook things, that pertain to Dell. And then they mine all of that information to try to help inform their strategy or head off things that may damage their reputation. But I think all folks are doing that. We sometimes are a little late to the table. And I think that if we could figure out ways, and it's one of the things that we're looking at the university, are ways that we can create a universe of our own data that helps us to that better informs us and can help drive our decision making, one, faster, and two, better informed. Mm-hmm. Google's 16 years old today. Isn't it? So.
Teenager.
Yeah, but you know, but there's a, you know, you hit on something, but that I think is probably worth mentioning, because I've had the occasion to meet and have dinner with Sergey Brin, who was one of the founders, he and Larry Page are the founders of Google. And they're cut from a different cloth, I guess I might suggest. And what I mean by that is, yes, they've made tons of money. But if you look at the things that Google is doing in today's day and age, it completely departs from a traditional IT company. I mean, they're trying to, you know, remote control cars, data repositories, internetworking the world, so high altitude balloons with networking capabilities, not quite satellites, but, you know, high altitude balloons over the Amazon or, you know, in very, very remote places. So, you know, I think that the view is not a traditional view, and as you would have had with the likes of IBM and some of the older, more staid companies. I think these new entrepreneurs are really looking at just what you're suggesting. You know, how do we then leverage what we have for the betterment of society, not just for profits? You know, I guess I'd also argue that, you know, just young folks who are coming out of school have a very different perspective. I mean, one, they work 24/7, all right? That's reality. I mean, you get up in the morning, you might do some email. You go to the gym, you know, you might do some email while you're on the treadmill. You come home, you do work, you get in the shower, you come out, you do a little more work, you go into the office, you have meetings, you leave with your buddies, go have a beer. You're checking your mobile device throughout that whole time while you're out. You come home, you do some more work, you go to sleep, you wake up in the middle of the night because you have an epiphany, you go back to your computer and so I think that our attitudes have to change in terms of accommodating. You know, that is a new reality as well. So no differently than there has to be digital literacy, there also has to be kind of a shifting in terms of how we are viewing folks and what people are doing now with their time. Because technology just has enabled so much.
It seems that society is polarizing because the group you're talking about there, that's one group. But there are other sectors of society that if you were in Barcelona, you still would know where the parking places were because your car would be like my car. It's 93 Volvo, so I don't have all of that. And then there are people who don't have a car. And so it's this polarity in society that public education was addressed so that you could have, say, a norm of literacy. Up to a certain age, people were required to go to school. And that meant that literacy had to be a norm. And you were trying to wipe out illiteracy, so we'd end X makers. Well, in the digital age, we got a lot of X makers. And the question is, how does a university, and I'm speaking now in general, not just about the University of Illinois, and it's a cultural question also, because there's a section of society that uses smartphones. There's a lot of yada yada, and there's a lot of texting, but how many characters that involves is not where you write a term paper, where you compose a letter, where you develop thoughts that are beyond just, you know, quick repartee back and forth. And it seems that we're in a real crisis. So when you mentioned Ferguson, for example, that reflects this other kind of inequality. When University Avenue separates the university from North Champaign, that's another reality in this town. So to me, that's what we're confronting today. And because to me, the question of Google, right? It's almost like the question of, are we going to regard Google as God? Because the dominance is so profound that the public, I guess what I'm really asking in this sense is, can the public ever accommodate itself to processing big data? Or will it just be another corporation or another bureaucracy? Because the public is we're becoming isolated from decision making, from democracy is what I'm really getting at.
Well,
I don't know how other people feel about that.
Yeah.
I think there's a version of it actually even in the library field, because we have a school now that is getting ready to introduce two degrees, not only our MLS but also information management. And in community informatics, I teach the hacker ethic, which is a book that you may have run across. And we haven't gotten to it yet, those of you that are in my class. But really, that book is about this new culture of hacking everything, right? Starting from the study of what computer programmers, how computer programmers work. And it's like we have, if the library is going to be in control of its own future, it has to start learning and practicing hacking the library. And the biggest data set that the library has is the circulation records, right? Which, on one hand, are extremely confidential, because what people check out and read is their own business. But if the future is to be data-driven, then in what way does a library take charge of that data and move the library forward into this age? Or is it something entirely different that I haven't thought of because I'm not a working librarian? I'm only a professor, you know, with one corner of the library curriculum in my remit. So there's, and I think of this as a digital divide in a sense, because we experienced it, like I say, in our own school, and we also experience it among our patrons. So, for instance, I've got one student who is a database specialist at the university, and the data she manages is the donor data. So the foundation's operations and all the units of the university come to her for data, but the problem is they don't often come to her because they don't even understand what that data could do for them. So they try to teach classes, but the foundation staff, the fundraising staff, doesn't have time to come to classes, so they don't come. And she and her colleagues struggle not to blame people. They should come. They can't come. They're too busy out raising money. They can't make that shift to using her database without the staff figuring out new ways of doing outreach to people and really showing them, maybe in a just-in-time fashion, how this new way of doing business can work, doing their work can do for them. So we experience it in all kind of levels, whether it's the extremes, like between your volunteer and board work at Micah's house, if that's the right way to pronounce Micah, and one community, but also even within the university itself, within one school. We've got two degrees developing, which the students in those degrees and our faculty need to talk to each other. There needs to be some melding in order for there to be some real advances made.
This is more of a comment than a question, I guess.
But.
Sure, but these are all big, tough issues. I mean, states don't fund education that's just a statement. I mean, they don't. So we have to look at, in my humble opinion, we have to look at other avenues of funding and other kinds of partnerships and other kinds of delivery mechanisms. And that's why I was speaking to some of my conversations with Sergey Brin, is they see these things as well and are very much interested, and they typically put their money where their mouth is. I mean, they were although we were the first at Case, it was right on the heels of Google's announcement to wire, I think it was Chattanooga, Lafayette, Kansas City. You know, so they see the importance of connectivity and access and invest in it that way. You know, I think we have to have some conversations with other kinds of funding mechanisms in order to get at this. I also would suggest that, and that's why I say that people have to take on some personal responsibility as well, because the example I use in Cleveland with my team, because people were not happy with the changes that I brought when I took over a Case, and those changes with the central IT organization were, we got to think about this completely different, because we no longer are the keepers of the keys to the technological kingdom. I use absolutely nothing on this thing from the university other than wireless connectivity, and quite frankly, that's kind of ubiquitous. So we have to figure out how to be relevant in the face of this as a new reality. And so we have to change and do things differently. We have to do the same thing around education. And there just will be some folks who don't take responsibility, who we can't move, who can't. And that might sound kind of harsh, but you know, you can't save everybody. And so you begin at some level, primarily with those folks
who are a coalition of the willing. And that's how we brought about change in terms of teaching technologies at Case. Is that I didn't try to go to every faculty member. I mean, because there are just some faculty members that said, who are you to tell me what I should be doing in my class? Yeah. And so instead of wasting time that way, we went and found folks who were coming to us and saying, hey, we want to try this. You know, you got to go and spend time investing in those who want to do differently, want to do better. And I would argue that there aren't very many people who don't have digital devices. You're correct that they don't use them, but they have the capability in their hands. And every one of these things comes with instructions on how to best utilize the applications that are on them. So at some point, there has to be some personal responsibility in changing yourselves and changing the lay of the land for yourself.
So earlier on, you showed the video. And so me personally, I'm like, bring it on. You know, it looked very exciting. But there's a large segment of our population who saw that as a, would see that as a nightmare. And then the, a lot of that group are the same people that UC2B was brought in to help. And so I agree with you, there needs to be a self-desire, self-pushing forward. But how do we reach that? You know, because I know we can't reach everybody. That would be an impossible goal. But we want to reach as many people as possible because we try to reach the lowest of ourselves. Because let's take Chicago, for example. Chicago's doing all these wonderful things with technology, but what is Chicago making a name for? It's not that. It's the bottom level that people we're not able to reach. And so we don't want to get to that point that when we just push people off, because if we just push them off, then they're going to lose hope. And when people lose hope, we see what happens.
Right. And I'm not suggesting that we just push people off.
Right, right.
You know, I think organizations like this are a step in that direction. I think some of the things that I have done going to schools, you know, as a black CIO, in a senior position, because look at me, you can see yourself in me, and let me take you around and introduce you to some other folks who are a lot like me and who look like me. So it is possible to apply yourself and move forward. And so the education around the art of the possible, I think, has to happen. And again, with technology, I mean, it's we can push those kinds of things, but you can lead to water, but you can't make it.
Abdul mentioned that there's this standardization of education in America, and that's been where if you were in eighth grade, you could probably read or write at an eighth grade level. They kept that standard for years, and it's been this increasing slope downward for all public schools. I want to know, in your capacity, your office, do you have any, I know your kind of future plans for public engagement for our school district, for the university to reach its arm back and kind of pull up our students' ACT scores, graduation rates, reading skills, because we have a lot of brains here, we have a lot of money here, we have a lot of resources here, and we have a lot of resources that are wasted here on this campus that can be used in the community. So with your title, with your influence, with your connections, we can use, like you've had these pilot programs that you did in your city. Been thinking about some of those pilot programs you could implement in our city to at least out of Champaign, we could say that at least in our high school, our eighth graders can read at an eighth grade level because only 8% of them do or whatever. So,
to be honest, I haven't thought a lot about that. I'm still drinking from a fire hose trying to land here on campus. But in general, what I can tell you is previously when I worked at GE and when I worked at Case, I mean, we sponsored those kinds of things. We adopted whole schools and sent engineers to spend time, over several days in the course of a week with a sponsored school to do just the kinds of things that you're talking about, to elevate students, to show students that you can succeed, you can do well. And there was an investment on the part of the company and on the part of the people to do those kinds of things. I encouraged it of my staff, then I would encourage it of my staff now. within whatever the rules of engagement are that govern the university. And I would do it in concert, probably with another department.
Brandon.
Yeah, I was wondering if you could talk a little about your thoughts on net neutrality. This year, there's this idea from our federal government, our FCC, of creating, you know, turning the internet into a slow lane and a fast lane. And, you know, we'd all be on the slow lane, I guess, unless we had some kind of huge corporate sponsorship to get up on the fast lane. What does that mean for our university, for our research, for our community? And how do we get awareness of that or tell that story so it makes sense and so that people can get involved appropriately? Because I think it's mostly an untold story, and there are a lot of people on our campus or in our community that even understand how it would change the internet as they know it and why it matters.
Oh, I think it matters because it's that the cornerstone of the things that we're even talking about. So to try to privatize some portion of it or assign costs that people would have to pay and cause the another divide, you know, is not in any way, shape, or form in our collective best interest. And we wrote in that case and with our government relations folks, supporting them in their lobbying efforts there. Yeah, I think it's a bad idea. But what I'd also offer is that, in the case of one community, is that we figured out how to fund ourselves so that we can provide, you know, 100 gigabit kinds of connectivity. How we were able to kind of privatize part of the business so that it could charge and make money to help to seed other activities so that we did remain neutral. So I think, one, you fight the fight at the political level, and two, we have to become kind of entrepreneurial in terms of what our models look like, because we have to be more in control of our destiny.
To what extent is the private sector having these conversations about this divide, or are they having those conversations?
I've been in several of them. I was at an executive briefing at Dell a couple of months ago, and their chief technology officer was talking about it, because it's in their best interest to ensure that the people who are in the pool from where they're going to gain their talent, you know, are capable. So yes, and that's a complaint in many respects from the likes of Michael Dell and others, is that there's kind of a disconnect in what they're looking for and in terms of what we provide. And so there's been some conversations, and in fact, I believe there's a school in Ohio who they don't really have courses as we know them. What they are is basically a clearinghouse for granting a degree for kind of self-directed degrees around technology and other kinds of things that corporations are looking for. Will that bring about the demise of places like this? No, but it's something that we ought to pay attention to. I guess the other thing I'd offer is I was highly encouraged when I had a conversation with the department head of computer science, and I was highly encouraged because, you know, he has a great problem. He has more students than he knows what to do with, and that's for the foreseeable future. But he is forging relationships with other parts of the campus, so that not only do these students graduate with a degree in computer science, but they also graduate maybe with a minor or some kind of specialization in anthropology or other kinds of disciplines. And so again, you can pursue these other disciplines undergirded by digital literacy. And I think that gets that.
I really wanted to follow up on exactly what you just said, because the question of what does digital literacy mean for an educated person in the 21st century? Does it mean the ability to use applications that somebody else wrote, or does it mean the ability to write code?
It is, well, in my humble opinion, it is the ability to utilize technology to enhance what it is that you do, and realize that technology is there that can view, that can support that. So that you understand, not only is this a telephone, but you know what? It's my GPS. It's my note-taking capability. It's where applications are for managing my finances. I can do any, I mean, there are probably more applications on here than I'll ever use, but it's the ability to grab these things and pull them together in some cohesive fashion that then enables me to be very, very productive.
But what you just said in terms of the computer science students, they learn to write code. They make applications. And the applications that come, if you're clever enough, particularly if it's open source, you can actually impact it and customize it to what you really want and need. Otherwise, when we go to the web, we download information. It's like going to the mall. It's assumed that the commodities we consume are the ones we want. And for me, I know when I go look for shoes, they've discontinued the shoes I like, so I can't even find the shoes I want. So then I'm making the shoes I want. And I'm not even sure they're making the applications I want.
Yeah, but I have yet to come across a time where there isn't something out there, either for free or for pay, that doesn't address a particular need that I have, either for free or for pay. There are millions and millions of applications that are out there. So yes, relative to the computer science students, that's because they have a desire to be able to code, but they also have desires beyond just code, or the desire to create something in a space where perhaps there's still room for some innovation, or I would even argue to create something that may not even exist today.
I just hate the idea that they think they're elite. They move, and the rest of us are just their customers, or, you know, is there a way to level this so that in the society we have more interactivity, we can determine what they make, because some of the tools they're making, I don't even know if that's what's in the best interest of our society to have those kind of things.
I would agree that just because we can do a thing, it isn't necessarily the thing to do.
Right.
But for those outfits that are in this to make a profit, they have to be aware of who their customers are. Or else, you know, just assume just as quickly as these startups emerge, they will vanish. And there's been, you know, thousands of them, because they weren't producing the things that people wanted. And now you can see developers who are in niche areas developing things. So there may be someone out there making those shoes that you like. It's just a function of being able to search, know that, use the tool, and go out there and find it.
We have time for a couple more questions. I saw that you had your hand up, and then we'll finish with Kate.
Yeah, just to talk a little bit more about the digital literacy question, I feel like it's a spectrum. Like, before you can learn how to write code, you need to learn how to interact with the computer, whether that be like using a keyboard or using a mouse or using touching the screen in the right way. And there are people who are ready to be done at different levels. Some people, they just want to know how to get from step one to step two so they can do this one specific thing. But that's like the beginning. And once they're comfortable with that, maybe they want to go on and do something else. And I feel like digital literacy is about like starting at the beginning and then, like you said, making people aware that there's technology that might be able to help you do what you want to do. But also, there might not be, and maybe you can get to a point where you do learn how to write code or do learn how to network with people who could make something that, to help you do what you want to do.
Intellectual property was the word I was trying to think of in my presentation. I'm sorry.
Yeah, I was what something Carly said jives exactly with what I wanted to say. Your example of Bob was a really interesting way to start your talk, because Bob was a situation of, it's not just what you know, it's who you know. And I think your ability to cruise to what you need, as you describe it, whether it's on your phone or somewhere else, is partly who you know and not just what you know. And that is that we have, among the IT savvy, we have an understanding that with the explosion of data, we also need to think more like a hive mind. We have to not be afraid to ask someone to catch you up on something, or to go to someone who's always on top of shoe technology or whatever. And I think we have to find ways to bring that culture to everyone. Because if you leave it up to, you have to learn, you have to learn, you have to learn, it's hard for them to move that forward fast enough. But if they understand, you have to learn, but you also have to hang with the people who know and share, blah, 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 blah. But then maybe we can all move forward a lot faster. But we don't have that, and that's why I go back to this hacker ethic thing, because the hacker culture is one of saying, I know something, you know something, let's try and share. And the divide, the polarization, puts us at risk of not being able to do that. Whether it's a divide on campus, which obviously the head of computer science is thinking about bridging himself, or it's a divide in the larger society, or in the library world, like I was talking about. So digital literacy doesn't just exist in a person, it exists in a network of people.
In fact, in his words, and I don't, it was amazing just how spot on Scott McNeely was. And Scott McNeely, for those who don't know, he was one of the founders and became CEO of Sun Microsystems, one of very highly successful company until they were bought out by Oracle. But even though he was a hardware manufacturer and systems person, he said that this stuff really doesn't matter. What he said is that the network is the computer. And in the absence of networks, be they human networks, and that's one of Cisco's, I guess, taglines, you never realize the full power. And it's the network of people that I think are the most powerful. Because there's very few things that you go off and do on your own in today's day and age. They're done in collaboration with others. And the technology has just made the world such a small place. Because I don't know if anyone caught it, but on that video, when the father, he's a neurologist, he was dealing with a colleague who was in China, real time, and the actual MRI took place in China. And so he was consulting in real time there. And so the world is a much, much smaller place enabled. So it is our ability really to interact with people that begins it. And that's, again, I gave the example of GE, we as people with kids in schools, me as a person going and investing and mentoring kids. That's at the root of it all.
Well, thank you very much.
Thank you.
We should just remind everybody that there are refreshments. We can continue this discussion, which is really important, in small groups. Please help yourself, and thanks for coming.
Thank you.